In the four pillars of the plan, there's a lot of new spending. So how would you propose to pay for that? Would taxes be raised? And if so, would the economy be hurt by that?
As you can see, the Green New Deal represents really a whole-scale reordering of our priorities. So, you know, currently we spend trillions of dollars a year on wars, Wall Street bailouts, tax breaks for the wealthy, in so many words. So $1 trillion a year on the bloated military industrial security complex. We see downsizing the military. It was basically doubled since the beginning of the 2000s without having really made us more secure or having successfully won the very protracted and extremely expensive and illegal wars that we've been involved in. So we're talking about bringing the troops home, downsizing the military, freeing up hundreds of billions of dollars on that account. We're also talking about healthcare that more than pays for itself. So the healthcare is actually not an expense. It's actually a revenue generator in that it frees up trillions of dollars over the course of the next decade. Same for student making public higher education free. Again, the numbers from the GI Bill showing that the return on the investment is about 7 to 1. So we need to think of these as largely investments. And the biggest one is going to be the job creation. And the estimates suggest it would be about the cost of Obama's 2009 stimulus package to jumpstart this. So you're talking $600, some maybe $700 billion. But instead of giving tax breaks, basically, and giveaways, and big corporate subsidies, instead it would be used for direct job creation.
Ms. Honkala, have you always affiliated with the Green Party, or were you previously a Democrat?
I have a family that's made up of, my immediate family is made up of African Americans, as well as I have two brother-in-laws, one from Kenya and one from the Sudan. And I was very much involved in the Obama campaign. The children, my nieces, that took to the street with bullhorns are now the African-American nieces living in my mother's living room. They lost their home to foreclosure.
How would you respond to critics who might say that if your plan was enacted, if you took office, that it would scare the business community and it would hurt the business climate, so they may be less likely to create jobs?
That certainly is the prevailing mythology, but you know, in my profession, I'm trained as a medical doctor, so we try to be guided by evidence on the ground. And I would say the evidence on the ground doesn't really support that, because you know, the business community, corporate America, has never had it better. Things have never been certain out there. You know, in the post-World War II climate, when the marginal tax rate was close to 90%, in the Clinton years when it was much higher, and Clinton actually raised the marginal tax rate from 35% to 39%, the economy was booming. So the facts on the ground just don't support that. And to look at the deregulation and the tax cuts for corporations and the wealthy over the Bush years, it didn't create a stable economy. It created an extremely unstable economy and paved the way for the crash that we have not been able to pull ourselves out of. And we still continue to teeter on the brink of several more crashes that could be immediately around the corner. So we need to get our house in order and to do it quickly in order to achieve that security. Security doesn't come from even greater corporate profits and cash on hand. It's never been greater than what it is.
What is the larger motivating force when you're talking about a party that best case scenario can get 2% of the vote, and yet you have to go through the rigors of a campaign and trying and trying and trying with the acknowledgement that it's not going to be yours to win? Is it the notion of generations down the road having built a base where the Green Party can?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think if we look at history, history doesn't go just like a straight line. Different things happen in history that propel things forward. And I think when Jill is talking about the tipping point, we're definitely there. We don't hear about the Rhonda Lancasters, we don't hear about the Glendas. There's an entire disconnect, I think, from your average everyday American across this country. And I think that as long as the 1% can continue to travel across the entire world and employ somebody for the lowest amount of money, we have to really begin to do something. I've been doing this work for 25 years, and we used to be able to get some kind of concessions or to at least, you know, the problem wasn't so bad. And now we're dealing with folks that have worked their entire lives, worked 2-3 jobs, and have a 4 or 8 year degree, who are now in the situation where they're losing their homes. And that's a very different time in history. And that those are folks that are used to going on vacation, saving up money to send their kids to school, these kinds of things. And so I don't think that the American people are just going to sit by and watch their families lose everything that they've worked their entire lives for.
So we've heard the 99% and 1% mentioned. Even if you're not Occupy candidates, do you see yourselves as completely aligned with that movement? And are there any either aspects of that movement or how they handled the power that they generated that you might criticize?
I think absolutely we are the perfect Occupy candidates. I think the only thing that I would see different is that I'm connected to one of the largest multiracial movements in the country. But definitely we tap into the sentiment of young people across this country that are very angry, unable to pay their student loans, and don't see much of a future in either Obama or Mitt Romney.